Professor Dave here, let's talk about retrosynthetic analysis.
He knows a lot about the science stuff, Professor Dave explains.
So we know that the task of the synthetic chemist is to build molecules. And oftentimes we may go out into nature and we may find some naturally occurring product that we find has medicinal properties and we think, wow, this is a great compound, but you know, it's only found in these tiny amounts in a sponge at the bottom of the Pacific Ocean. Wouldn't it be great if we just had a ton of it? Well, guess what? We can build it ourselves. Now, the thing is, we have to find a synthetic pathway to build that molecule, and if it's a very complex molecule, it's obviously going to be very complicated to do. But there's a method called retrosynthetic analysis. So It's a lot like starting a maze from the finish and trying to find the start. So instead of starting with some arbitrary molecule and trying to think, what can I do to this to get to the target molecule, what we do is we start with the target molecule and then we very selectively break it apart into smaller pieces in very specific ways. We will only break it apart in such a way that is feasible because we know that there is some reaction that will put it back together in the way that we just pulled it apart. And so in order to do this, we need to basically look at the functional groups on the target molecule and think of what kinds of reactions can generate those functional groups. So I've drawn three examples here. Let's say we're looking at this compound. Let's say the allowed starting material is alcohols of three carbons or less. Okay, so we know that this is an alcohol. We need to build an alcohol from smaller pieces. What reactions do we know that make alcohols? Well, if you're in an Organic 1 course, the first thing that might come to your head is a Grignard reaction. So let's say we're going to make a Grignard. Now, the kind of analysis that we need to do here, we're going to be drawing these retrosynthetic arrows that do not represent reactions. They represent the undoing of reactions. They mean back in time. And so what we're saying is, how can we pull that molecule apart in a strategic way that represents a disassembling that creates fragments that, when they react, will come back together to create that? Well, we know that when we do a Grignard reaction, it is the carbon attached to magnesium, which is the nucleophilic carbon, that makes a new carbon-carbon bond with what was the carbonyl carbon of a ketone or aldehyde. So this must have been the carbonyl carbon in the substrate, and then either of these can have been the carbon that attacked it. Well, let's look at our guidelines. We need alcohols of three carbons or less, so let's do ourselves a favor and split this up here. So when we do retrosynthetic analysis, we're either transforming functional groups or we're pulling the parent molecule apart into smaller pieces in a way that we know that we'll be able to put them back together in exactly that way. So if we pull those apart, this arrow means what came before that could have been this. Right? This is a valid retrosynthetic step. These are valid retrosynthetic precursors to this, because if this Grignard reagent and this aldehyde react, we will get that molecule. So that's how retrosynthetic analysis works. We're being very strategic in the way we pull apart a larger molecule. And this is a very simple example. If we have some giant polycyclic structure, obviously this gets pretty complicated, but then you're getting into PhD territory. So we'll settle on these simple ones. Now over here, we do need alcohol. So this piece can go back to the alcohol. This is a valid retrosynthetic step because we know that from this alcohol, we can get that aldehyde using an oxidizing agent like PCC. Same thing goes right here. We know that with this guy, this can have come from the alkyl bromide, which can have come from the alcohol, because we know that in the forward direction, PBr3 will give us that, and then reacting with magnesium will get us that. So in any retrosynthetic strategy, we should number one, retrosynthesize all the way back to the allowed starting material. These are both alcohols of three carbons or less, so that meets the criteria of what we're allowed to start with. Then we have to go back in the forward direction and make sure that it's going to work. Well, like we said, PBr3 will give us that, magnesium will give us that, PCC will bring us from there to there, and if these two react, we do get our target molecule. So that's how retrosynthetic analysis works. Let's take a look at these other two guys here. Over here, we've got an alkyne, and we want to make this from alcohols of four carbons or less. So again, what we need to do is say, what kind of molecule is this? What functional groups are present? And what reactions do I know that generate those functional groups? Well, we know that this is an alkene. This is an alkene. And what reaction do we know that makes an alkene? Well, off the top of our heads in Organic 1 course, we might think of the Wittig reaction. So let's say we're doing a Wittig. Let's retro-Wittig this thing. Right? And we know that when we do a Wittig reaction, the negatively charged carbon on the yllid and the carbonyl carbon end up having a double bond together. So that means one of these must have been the carbonyl carbon and the other must have been the yllid carbon. So let's arbitrarily assign one to one and the other to the other, it doesn't matter which, but we can say that this came from this. We'll say that. Okay, so here's the four carbon fragment, here's the three carbon fragment, and this is a valid retrosynthetic step once again, because if we react acetone with this Wittig reagent, we will get this product. So that's why this is a valid back in time kind of a step. Now once again, we want to go all the way back to alcohols. This guy's no problem. This can have come from isopropanol because in the forward direction we can oxidize. And then over here we know this can have come from an alkyl bromide, which can have come from an alcohol. So we have met the criteria. These are both alcohols of four carbons or less. And then to double check in the forward direction, we know that if we react with PBr3, we're going to get the alkyl bromide. We react with triphenylphosphine and some base, we're going to get the Wittig reagent. This has to have a negative charge right there. And we know that if we oxidize that with PCC or KMnO4, we're going to get the ketone. And then if this ketone and this Wittig reagent react, we will get this alkene product. So this is once again a valid retrosynthetic strategy. Now, sometimes they're just one step. We oftentimes, maybe in a quiz or something, instead of saying, here are some reactants, what do you get? We might have a product and say, what did they come from? So even if it's not a very large multi-step pathway, it might just be one step. We still have to be able to think retrosynthetically. We have to be able to think, where did this come from? So let's say we want to form this from six-membered rings. Well, what do we know that makes six-membered rings? Diels Alder reaction. So we want to take a look at this and say, well, here's a pi bond right there, and where are the two sigma bonds? We know that any Diels Alder is going to take three pi bonds and it's going to shuffle them around to make a pi bond and two sigma bonds. Well, why don't we undo some sigma bonds that can have led to the formation of that Diels Alder product? So what we're saying is, if we undo that, if we do a retro Diels Alder, then that must have come from these, right? Here's our diene, here's our dienophile, and this works because we can always check, we can write the mechanism. If we try to combine these via Diels Alder, we are going to get that product. So the key thing to understand with retrosynthetic analysis is that we are always looking at a target molecule and strategically pulling it apart in ways that make sense, because for everything that we undo, we know of a way to redo it. Okay, and then if you have some designated starting material, you need to keep going until you get there. But in general, these are the basics of any retrosynthetic analysis. Thanks for watching, guys. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.